let's move on with our guest. Eh?
Yeah, let's. So today we're welcoming, in addition to our new recruit, Dick Lutz, from Rockingham Conservation Commission, Malin Clyde. She is an organizer, a staff person with New Hampshire Cooperative Extension, and she's been working with them for close to 20 years on environmental volunteerism. She is kind of the genius behind their new branding called Nature Groupie, which she explains as an Airbnb for environmental volunteering. And it's really a fabulous website, naturegroupie.org. So I would like to welcome Malin Clyde into the studio today.
Thanks a lot, Lisa. It's fun to be here.
Super. So Malin and I had a little bit of time to chat a week or so ago about all the cool things. I've been getting Nature Groupies emails now for, for a while. The brand was released just in January. And maybe you can tell us a little bit about kind of the genesis of that and what the goal is.
Sure, happy to. The project that is now Nature Groupie started 5 or 6 years ago, and it really grew out of my work in extension with lots of conservation partners in New Hampshire, land trusts, but also town conservation commissions and federal agencies, state agencies like New Hampshire Fish and Game. And I've always worked with volunteers in natural resources, but Extension has lots of other volunteer programs. So we have master gardeners in our agricultural programs. We have our entire 4-H program is run by volunteers for youth development. So we have a long tradition in Extension of working with volunteers. But I had noticed, having trained all these community volunteers in natural resource topics, that many of our conservation partners struggled to work with volunteers. And I sort of wondered why. Why were there not very many volunteer opportunities out there being posted by our conservation partners? So I started having conversations with them and just found out, you know, their staff capacity was low. They didn't have a lot of tradition of posting volunteer opportunities. They might be trying to recruit volunteers by putting a notice on their website saying, call Marianne if you're interested in volunteering. And I think we all know now we want to know a little bit more information than that before pretty much we do anything, including, you know, buy a pair of shoes or go to a restaurant. So I just really thought there was a model out there to try to bring more people to volunteering for all of our conservation partners. So it really stemmed from a need from the conservation community, from organizations to needing help working with volunteers.
Excellent. And we know what a struggle it is sometimes to get volunteers, good, talented volunteers to us. And so your website really provides kind of the hub to get people excited about volunteering, find opportunities where they can lend a hand. One of the things we chatted about was this kind of this new spirit of volunteerism, which I think has been cultivated with high schools having community service requirements. And that's really kind of planted a seed. I hate to use that acronym, but
okay, go ahead.
Planted a seed with this generation of millennials who are still looking to apply themselves and to contribute in some way. Can you give us a little bit more about kind of where that came from and how you've capitalized on that?
Yeah, well, I sit, my office is on the UNH campus, and so we, of course, surrounded by young people and students at UNH, and it just, we see students involved in so many different kinds of initiatives, whether it's recycling or sustainability or helping kids. They're just a font of enthusiasm and energy, and I think that that has started, you know, that they didn't just come to college and start doing that. It's really part of the culture so much more than from when I was younger. So I've just been really impressed by that. But also when we were going out and talking to conservation partners about what they needed around volunteers, and, you know, it turns out they pretty much across the board said, we want younger people. You know, the people that helped start and found our conservation organizations and who continue to volunteer are aging out, and we're not sure how to recruit the next generation of volunteers. So we just started talking to people around campus and young professionals to find out, you know, what do they need? How do they get their information? What do they need to volunteer? What motivates them? And that really helped shape what we built for the Nature Groupie website, and actually really helped inform our rebranding that happened this year, because you know, it really speaks the name Nature Groupie, although maybe it doesn't speak to absolutely everyone out there. It's very memorable, and it really resonated with younger people. So we're really just trying to use marketing tactics, which I hope is not a dirty word, to reach out to the next generation of volunteers, because our conservation organizations, you know, very super dedicated and earnest, but they're really reaching out to donors a lot of the time. That's their main audience. They're trying to support their really important work. But you know, volunteers are another audience who might not be today's donors, but they might be, you know, the next donate in a decade. But they're also looking for ways to contribute. So that's what Nature Groupie is hopefully doing, is bringing a new group of people to all of our conservation partners' work.
So can we back up for 1 second? So did you create this website, the naturegroupie.org thing and all?
Yeah,
all
about 5 years ago, we started with a different name, it had the word stewardship in it, which really spoke to our conservation partners in thinking about they wanted help caring for land and water. And we found a partner in the Midwest who had built something called the Stewardship Network, and we got a grant to sort of adapt that model here in New England. But what happened was it really took off with conservation partners. So we have groups from all over New England who post their volunteer opportunities on this one website. So it's a real collaborative effort. And after about 4 years, we realized the table was set. Like there's something on the calendar almost every day during the busy field season. But what we realized was, with the increasing number of things that are on the calendar, we need a geometric increase in the number of volunteers, because every volunteer opportunity might need 10 to 20 more people. So we can get either our existing people to volunteer more, or, you know, really to get more people looking at it. So we have about 3,000 people who subscribe to our weekly bulletin, and some couple thousand more on social media. But if we have 3,000 now, what is it going to take us to get to 30,000? Because really what we heard from our conservation partners is they want to help create a culture of stewardship in New England or New Hampshire or Great Bay or any of our smaller regions. And if you're talking about, and that meaning somebody's going to go kayaking and maybe have a craft beer, but then also going to spend a couple of hours a year, maybe a couple times a year, volunteering to help care for the places they love, we've got to make it easy. And for cultural change, that means more than 3,000 people, right? It means like a lot of people. So how do we make volunteering for the environment more welcoming? And we found out using words that are not stewardship is one way to make it seem more welcoming.
Groupie makes me feel like I'm at a Dead concert or
exactly.
Something like that. But so I'm looking at the website right now. You have a calendar that's up here, and so the items on the calendar, for instance, tomorrow at 9 a.m. there's the Woodsome Farm tree planting. 9:30 adopt the site training day at and pepperweed pull. Now you don't know where that is, but you could click on it and get more information. Plum Island friend and family pepperweed. I don't even know what pepperweed is. I should
Doesn't
learn about that.
Intrigue you? Don't you want to click on that?
Yes.
Find out
so what you would do is you'd click on it, right? And that's going to take you to the link and give you more details and who you should contact. And so these organizations, the sponsoring organization, the Parker River National Wildlife Refuge, they get access to the site and they can upload their event, you know, on their own. Now, as a consumer of this, can you filter it to say I want to get emailed things that happen within 10 miles of my home or something like that?
That's such a good question. We got a grant from the Charitable Foundation to do just that, upgrade our technology. So coming out later in the summer, you'll be able to filter on lots of things, place being one of them, but also whether things are family friendly, whether they're outdoors. Most of the things are outdoors, but in the winter, they're not all outdoors. There's lots of training things indoors. But that distance is important to people. Although you'd be surprised, one of the amazing things that we've learned from having over 200 conservation groups posting in the same place is we can actually look at the data, because you actually can register for all these events through the system. That was something our partners needed, is some online registration that you can do on your phone. And so we're able to see that over 50% of the people who are volunteering for the outdoors through Nature Groupie are volunteering outside their home county. So not just outside the town that they live in, but outside the county that they live in. So I think it's been surprising to us and to our partners how far people will travel. So we started asking people when we go to events, we say, well, you know, what made you come today? And they almost universally say, well, I just had time today. So we're so busy that it's really about what I have time, what day I have open. So distance is important, but not as important as I think we all would have thought. Right. So that's been really, really interesting that people want to make a difference, but they're willing to travel a little bit to, you know, obviously it's better if it's right next door, but it's not always possible on the day we're available.
It's kind of an ecotourism. You can go to get out of town and do some volunteering and see something new.
Well, that and I can see if there was a map-based interface, you know, you'd learn about some place that is a place you've always wanted to go, or a place that is a favorite place of yours that, hey, they're doing something in a park or at a site that I love. I'll put that on my calendar. You know, I can see it being used as a tool in lots of different ways. And as far as the term groupie, you know, I'm thinking about where groupie came from, right? It came from the 60s. And a lot of these people who were part of that movement are people who created these conservation groups and who really are the engine of them. So I think it's a term that really crosses generations and hopefully connects them and brings them all together.
Well, what really convinced me, we actually had a really creative marketing person come up with the name, but what convinced me was people are already starting to use Nature Groupie online, so as a hashtag. So it was already out there, and although nobody owned it, so that was kind of amazing. But also that nowadays group shots that you take as a selfie are being called groupies. So that was kind of funny too. So it's really got some clever social media ability to sort of play with it a little bit.
It's got some legs there.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things we chatted about, which I thought was really interesting and kind of very inspiring, was the interest in families in kind of dedicating themselves. You mentioned a family that tries to volunteer 100 hours a year, which is essentially one day a month, with their entire family as kind of part of in cultivating that sense of community and volunteerism. Are a lot of your activities kind of family friendly? I see the Great Green Crab Hunt coming up next week, and I'm thinking that would be great to bring some 6 and 7 year olds out to go scamper around and look for green crabs.
Yeah, I mean, we have really been encouraging our partners, and it's part of the form when they submit a volunteer opportunity. We explicitly ask, what are the special instructions for youth? And almost all of the projects are suitable for families. It's just because of the tradition of conservation organizations, they're not always thinking about families first, but knowing the values of people out there with young kids and in New Hampshire in general, people love the outdoors. They want to introduce their kids to the outdoors, but also doing it in a structured way with a person there who's a quote-unquote expert about the environment. They can meet some interesting professionals, as well as go to a new place that we were talking about before. So I think we love it when we see people coming to these events with families, and we again want to, in our next website iteration, we'll be able to sort by family friendly, and it will be, and most of the things are family friendly. They might have some special you know, that you have to come with your parents or something like that, but it's really great. Cleanups are wonderful, but also invasive plant work, kids love that. So there's lots of ways to involve families, and I think it is about trying to express your own values and pass them on to your kids. And we just are, again, trying to make volunteering for the environment more accessible to everyone.
And I don't know, when I was a kid, my parents would have jumped all over this because it's a lot cheaper than going to an amusement park, too.
It's free, actually.
So on the other side of the coin, though, we had talked a little bit about the social aspect of this volunteerism and kind of bringing in new volunteers with some extra social element to some of these volunteering activities. Maybe you can give us an idea of what that front looks like.
Well, we're learning about, by talking to our volunteers, what they experience when they volunteer outdoors. And of course, we're talking about for all different kinds of volunteer, or I mean, all different kinds of volunteer opportunities. So it could be with Fish and Game, it could be with the Southeast Land Trust, it could be with the White Mountain National Forest. But universally, people mentioned that it was really fun to meet other people who are also volunteering next to them. I think there's something really unique and special about working alongside other people. You end up talking to people more so than if you're just going to hear music or a lecture or something like that. You're in it together. So I think the social aspect is sort of a surprise to people. There's a lot of happiness and joy that you see on people's faces. We get to capture that in photographs, but they also talk about it. And again, that really lent us, in part of our name change, we have an orange creature that's part of our logo that was really meant to express the joy and fun and happiness. And then, of course, the word group in groupie is really about the social connections that we see happening. And again, across ages, it's also pretty rare to go to things where there's not just your own age group, and so having college kids, young families, older people all at the same event working alongside each other, to me it's magic when it happens.
Super. It's like the perfect community event. I know that I've done a lot of trail building back in the old days, and yeah, a lot of people I've ended up maintaining long friendships and associations with are people that I, you know, met building bridges and clearing trails for mountain biking. So it's kind of an interesting, there's a, the event itself self-selects for the type of people, their interests, their ability to kind of step out of their, beyond their boundaries and jump in and roll up their shirt sleeves. So I think that it's a great synergy that gets created in these volunteering events. I wanted just to maybe look at a couple of upcoming events that I mentioned, the Green Crab Hunt, which looks so much fun, perfect for school age kids. It's from 3 to 4:30 on Tuesday. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. It's actually organized by my colleagues in Cooperative Extension, part of something called the Coastal Research Volunteers. And they actually had so much success with it last month that they've decided to do it every month for the season. And it's part of a growing field called citizen science, where scientists are involving citizen observers to collect data to inform research. And this is part of the Green Crab Project. Green crabs are actually an invasive crab that are found all over the place. But they're, Dr. Gabby Bratt at UNH is trying to understand the cycle of their molting in order to hopefully create a crab industry. Because if we have people out there collecting and eating green crabs as part of perhaps a new softshell crab fishery, it can help slow their spread. So it's kind of a creative use, but we don't actually know that much. You have to be out there a lot to be collecting the crabs at different times of their molt. So Gabby is using the data collected by families and green crab hunters on these series of days or throughout the summer to inform her research. So it's both fun and you're helping science and maybe local food industry.
And maybe you should have a guy with one of those steamer pots on the shore. store and steam them up and see, okay, do we bonfire. Like these green? Do we like these green good? Crabs
I'm
or not?
I'm sure Gabby has done that. I have not done that yet.
Yeah.
So this particular event is happening Tuesday afternoon, starting at 3 o'clock, which is a great way if you've got kids after school. Their athletics may have wrapped up for the school year. Get them down to Pierce Island and have them help out from 3 to 4:30. What else do we have coming up?
Well, I want to know what pepperweed is. Phil, does anyone know here what the pepperweed scene is? Never even heard the term before.
Dick, is this in your...
I don't know what pepperweed
is.
All
right.
Good. I can pretend to be an expert. Pepperweed.
You raise your hand.
Okay.
All right.
I'll take that one. Pepperweed is also an invasive species, but it's a plant. And it's not, we actually have very few pepperweed plants here in New Hampshire, really, because we've been very vigilant. We also have a very small coastline. But the folks down at the Parker River National Wildlife Refuge, which is Plum Island, basically, they have a pretty involved program to be pulling pepperweed from the shores. It's a coastal species. It's actually a certain time of year, right about now, it's very easy to identify, particularly from a boat or a kayak. So it's basically helping survey for it and pull it, and they're keeping very close data on where it is. I think there's maybe one or two instances of pepperweed here in New Hampshire, but we go and pull it every time it's seen. So it's a great way to learn a new plant. You can help be on the lookout for it here in New Hampshire and Maine if you go down and learn about it up on Plum Island. Again, what a beautiful place to go volunteer. But you also get to meet biologists, meet other volunteers, and get really up close and personal with pepperweed. So and I guarantee if you spend even an hour with a single invasive plant, you will never forget that plant. It's just impossible because you get so familiar with it. Putting your hands on it, smelling it, it'll be imprinted. It's so hard to learn a plant from a book, but really handling a plant like that, particularly pulling it, you will never forget it. So we want more people out there recognizing some of these invasive plants.
So what's pepperweed look like?
A white flower.
is it in the water? Is it in the
Yeah, it's a marsh plant. It's in the marsh plant. Yeah, okay. But again, it's really hard to describe something we don't see very often here in New Hampshire. In fact, I've never seen it here in New Hampshire. It's one of the challenges about invasive plants is it's easiest to keep them from spreading when they're right at the beginning of their invasion of a new place. But of course, we don't know the plant in the place that it's very new. So it's actually great to be able to go down to Massachusetts, not very far away, again, a beautiful place, learn the plant so more of us can be on the lookout for it here. But it's, it's an herbaceous, kind of grows somewhat tall, but it's often growing around other, very green marsh, cattail or coastal species. It might be in the salt water, so other sort of saltwater species, but at a certain time of year, it's flowering and nothing else is. So that's why they do it during this, small
when you can identify it.
Period.
And they've got a number of those pulls planned in the next weeks or so, including one that includes a little pizza party with it. So I encourage our listeners, if you're interested, to get onto naturegroupie.org and take a look at the calendar and what's coming up. There are a few of those I saw happening in Newmarket, not with pepperweed, but with garlic mustard.
Yeah.
Mustard, garlic
has
mustard.
Does anybody know that one?
That one I know.
You know that one, yeah. So that's an upland plant. So it grows not in the wetlands. It's been in New Hampshire for at least 10 years. I live in Durham, and I saw it by the side of the road, I don't know, about 7 years ago. And I was familiar with it because I moved here 20 years ago from the Midwest. And it was already in the Midwest. I had never seen it here. And I thought, what is that plant doing here? And since then, it's spread a lot in the seacoast. Garlic mustard is one of those things that we sponsor something with Nature Groupie called the Garlic Mustard Challenge, which is where we're challenging our conservation partners to hold volunteer work days around pulling garlic mustard. It's really easy to pull. And just like pepperweed, it's really easy to identify at this time of year. It's distinctive white flowers is very pretty, but pretty soon it'll go to seed, so we want to pull it before it goes to seed. But it's great for kids, actually. My son can spot this a mile away. He's now pulled so much of it. You bag it up to make sure the seeds don't develop. Then you can report the number of bags that you've pulled as a conservation group or as a private landowner on our website. And we have this really cool map that shows all the different amounts of garlic mustard pulled, but also areas hopefully will track over time, places where it's been eradicated, so garlic mustard free sites. So it's not a super common plant yet,
but the key is getting it before it seeds, because it just explodes when you grab it and it's seeded.
Yeah, they fly. It's like they have lives of their own, the little seeds. They pop off.
Well, it's like dandelions.
Yeah.
And you try to keep the dandelions at bay.
Yeah.
So I don't see anything on the Japanese knotweed pull anywhere there. I'm struggling with Japanese knotweed right now at my office building.
It's tough. It's not one that volunteers can really do much about, unfortunately.
Yeah, I mean,
unfortunately.
That is a nasty, nasty plant.
It really is. I have it. My neighbor has a small patch of it. It's the only patch in my neighborhood, and I've realized I need to go have a
the conversation.
Yeah, have a conversation.
You're gonna go there at night.
I have to be helpful.
I hate to say it, you go there at night with the Roundup, and you kind of spray the Roundup.
I think they'll be willing, but most people just don't recognize. I've done so many nature walks in my career, and it's really good reminder. I grew up loving plants. My parents taught me trees and plants, but I'm not from New England, and so I've had to relearn the plants here. But you realize on nature walks, people have told me, "Oh, wow. It's all just green to me. I didn't even know the differences between plants." So if we don't even know that, how can we possibly identify a few invasive plants? So there's a lot of environmental education that is part of volunteering. I think it's actually a really great way to learn new things, to be working and handling with your hands on. You don't have to learn every plant. You just have to learn a few, and then all of a sudden it'll pop out.
And the ones to stay away from, like poison ivy.
Yes.
Yeah, stay away from that.
Yeah.
So it makes me think of the other invasive, bittersweet, right? Oh, along the shoreline and things like
tough.
That, which is, that's another tough one, like knotweed. I mean, it just goes and goes and goes. You can pull the plant, but the roots are traveling another 30 feet underground somewhere.
And the birds are dropping the seeds.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Under any tree, there will be more bittersweet growing.
Yeah, I think one of the big lessons about invasive plants is, or invasive, actually, probably invasive anything, is, you know, we can't consider it a war, because I think many of these species are here to stay. It's really, we really encourage people in extension to think about what you're trying to protect. And so if you have a special place like the wildlife refuge or a rare plant that is in an area that you're trying to keep invasives out from damaging that special place, or because we can't get rid of everything. And they do perform a function in the landscape. They provide cover. They do provide food for birds and other wildlife. And, you know, to really go to war with them would mean the use of so many chemicals and money. Somebody once noticed, you know, to get rid of invasives on a property, it might cost as much as it would to buy a new property. So, similar with thinking about risk, you also have to think about the cost benefits of it. But again, if you get a plant early or a new invader early, that's really the time to put your volunteers and your muscle to work to try and hold it at bay.
Right. I noticed there was a I can't find it again somewhere in here about a rabbit count or something that. And
yeah.
I have to share this story when we talk about invasives. So
yeah.
I'm over on Badger's Island in Kittery.
Oh yeah.
And last fall, Maine Fish and Game shows up at the end of our road and starts placing traps around in this area of bush next to our yard and around the end. And it turns out what they were doing, I think I have this right, the New England cottontail is indigenous to the area, but the eastern cottontail is an invasive species. And I believe, they believe in Maine, that the eastern cottontail hasn't made it over to Maine, but they were finding it on Badger's Island.
Wow.
And the belief was it might have come across, swum across the river or come across the Memorial Bridge when it was closed for a while there and there weren't vehicles on it or something. So they've been trapping them and all that. And I guess they got a pretty good haul off of the island. It's good for me because my kale is a lot safer now from it. Maybe the electric fence I have around it isn't needed, but chipmunks are out, though. They're going after it. In any case, so one day I'm walking back from downtown, some event downtown, and there's a rabbit squished along the center line on the bridge, about, you know, a third of the way onto the Memorial Bridge. And I'm like, wow, this is interesting. I should take a photograph of it. Send it next time I see one of the fishing game guys checking his traps. I go, hey, by the way, there was a rabbit like a week ago that got squashed on the bridge or hit and sitting on the center line. And he's like, oh, can you show me where it was? And I got a photograph too. He goes, yeah, but let's go out. Let's go look for it. And we go out on the bridge. And it's, of course, it's not still there. It's a week later. But he goes into the bushes. And someone had taken the rabbit, thrown it in the bushes. He finds it. And the only way they can really tell the difference is DNA testing. So they're doing DNA testing of these rabbits. And a little while later, I get an email that says, can you send me the photograph? And I fire him the photograph. And he comes back. He goes, do you know what direction the rabbit was going? So I'm like, well, Mr. Rabbit, his head was facing north, squashed on the center line. But I thought that was kind of funny, like, what do you mean, do I know what way the rabbit was going? He's been rolled by a car in the middle of the Memorial Bridge. But really interesting that it's hard visually to really tell the difference. And they're literally doing DNA testing of these rabbits. And I don't know how they figured out originally that the eastern cottontail had made it onto the island. But they feel pretty confident that at least they caught the rabbits that were hanging out on Badger's Island. But so
that is such a great story. Yeah. My colleagues at UNH in Extension work a lot with the New England Cottontail Restoration. So they built this new reporting site called New Hampshire Rabbit Reports. And it's really to allow people like you. You could have uploaded your photo, although you're over in Maine, so I don't know. Maybe they would have accepted it.
All depends how far over the river
exactly.
I was.
Exactly. I know, halfway, right, or a third of the way, that maybe New Hampshire. Really to try to understand where New England cottontails are. They know actually where New England cottontails are, but they don't know where eastern cottontails are always, how dense those populations are. I think one, my colleague always says, if you see the rabbit out in the open, it's an eastern cottontail. They're much less fearful of predators. They can see better. So yeah. New England cottontails are in the...
The New Englands have a shorter ear.
Okay.
And they're made for stealth, where the cottontail is made for, the eastern is made for speed.
Uh-huh.
No self-respecting New England cottontail will be caught outside of a bush.
Right. So if you see it and you can take a picture of it, it's usually an eastern cottontail. Or a hare, a snowshoe hare.
So we failed to reintroduce Malin, right?
I got it right.
Malin Clyde. Who is helped put together this website, naturegroupie.org. So if you're interested in volunteering in finding out what's out there going on with a nature-oriented thing, naturegroupie.org. I'm wondering, one question, because we are going to have to wrap up the hour in just a few minutes. If you wanted to, with the new iteration of that's coming out in the fall, you said maybe, like if you said, I just want to hear about kayak events, I'm assuming you could probably put kayak as your keyword, and you're just going to get notices for kayak events within 50 miles.
Yeah, there'll be lots of ways to filter events. And again, we didn't build that in at the beginning because we weren't sure how busy the calendar would be, but really excited to see the explosion of volunteer opportunities that from all these different partners. And they're not just in New Hampshire. They're in Maine. They're in Massachusetts. A few in Vermont. Few in Connecticut. But it really is exciting to see how much there is to do, and it's all in one place. So it really makes it easier to find
well,
something.
Well, that's great. Any last words?
Well, I just want to kind of reiterate to our listeners that it's not just about invasive species. I mean, there's lots of our conservation groups are concerned about these invasive species, and that's a great way to get volunteering together. This is a perfect opportunity. But there's trail building activities, there's planting activities, there's various things all over the state. If you're traveling or you're vacationing in the state of New Hampshire and want to integrate a little bit of this type of community involvement where you're vacationing, you know, take a look at the calendar, because there's a lot of really exciting, interesting.
I saw water bar there, and I thought that had something to do with getting on a river with a bar with a few beers and drinks on it and all that.
That's after you volunteer to clean out water bars.
Actually, the water diversion bars on trails.
Doing
that up in North Conway.
And that's a great trail building skill, which you can, you know, adopt and use on lots of other projects going down the road, you know. So it's skills for you, it's community building, it's a great way to, you know, give back and get involved, and it's a very low cost admission price. It's free. The cost of your transportation to get to the site is basically all it'll cost you. I may even take Tuesday afternoon off and go green crab hunting.
I hope you do.
Yeah. And try one. Let me know what it tastes like. So, naturegroupie.org.
Yeah, and you can join. We are on social media, so we have an Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, but also we have a weekly bulletin that you can go to naturegroupie.org and sign up to get that. It's free. So every Tuesday, you'll find out all the new things that have been posted in the last week.
Sounds great. Well, thanks for joining us.
Thanks a lot.